Hi, everyone. My name is Cindy Chmielewski, and I've been living with multiple myeloma since 2008. Back in 2008, I was a fifth grade teacher, and I simply loved my job. But back in around 2006, it became very difficult to teach. I was experiencing this excruciating back pain, and standing at the blackboard was very hard. Recess duty was almost impossible, and I couldn't even take my class on a field trip. The tears would come down my cheeks. That's how much pain I was in. And for the next 2 years, I was prescribed pain medication and physical therapy. And you have to see, back in 2006, 2008, I was a very different person than I am now. I grew up in that age of doctor knows best. So I really didn't question what my doctor was doing, although I thought that maybe we should be taking an x-ray of my back. And the rest is history. I was diagnosed with IgG kappa, stage 3 multiple myeloma. The multiple myeloma was in over 99% of my bone marrow. I started treatment immediately. The treatment back in 2008 are very different than now. And in the beginning, I had a tough time. The treatments were not touching my myeloma. I had initial success, but then it stopped working. I had a stem cell transplant, and that didn't work. And I was devastated. I really didn't think I was going to live much longer. And luckily, a treatment that my doctor suggested began working for me, and it worked so well that I put my disease in a remission. And since probably about 2010, I've been on maintenance therapy and able to live my life. And in the meantime, I retired from teaching because I didn't know what I was going to be doing. And now I'm a different person. I don't teach fifth graders. I teach myeloma patients about myeloma and how important it is to be actively involved in your care, not to be that person like I was back in 2008 and just blindly following my doctor's orders. It's important to learn all you can about your myeloma and to ask questions and to be there to make decisions. And it's so exciting because now there are so many treatments to choose from that if one thing stops working, there are just so many other choices. And that's just a little bit of my story. And that's what today's conversation is about. We're going to be talking to two myeloma specialists about the latest happenings for the newly diagnosed population. Usually, newly diagnosed is broken up into two groups, transplant eligible and transplant ineligible. And before we even start talking about what's happening in that area, how are those defined? Like, how do you know if I'm a transplant eligible patient or ineligible?
Good question. And actually a bit of a moving target. We used to kind of say that transplant eligible or transplant ineligible, which I should say is usually kind of assigned at the time of diagnosis. So a patient first gets diagnosed with multiple myeloma, the oncologist, you at least historically kind of got just kind of a gestalt or a gut instinct to say this patient is younger, older, healthier, less healthy, what we call a performance status, a good performance status, meaning that they're independent with their activities of daily living. They can bathe themselves. They live alone. They do their own grocery shopping, you know, whatever it is. Historically, we'd look at a patient and say, healthy, not healthy, old, young, and kind of make kind of, just generic assignments to people. And that's really challenging to do when someone's first diagnosed with myeloma, because many times when you're first diagnosed, you're sick. You don't feel good. You've spent months kind of trying to figure out what's going on. It may have taken a while to get the diagnosis. At that point, many bones have been affected by myeloma. It can be very painful. And a lot of people just aren't all the things that we think of what normal health is, let's say. So traditionally, we had made assignments when patients were first diagnosed to say, you're healthy enough, strong enough, well enough that you can get an intensive regimen called a bone marrow transplant or not. Now, I will say, though, I think there's been a bit of an evolution to the concept of transplant eligibility as some more data has kind of emerged to say, does everyone have to get a transplant? where maybe we don't need to use those same kind of assignments to make that determination. And so I would argue to say, I think the better way to distinguish between patients who may be able to get a transplant and patients who may not is frailty. So frailty is a little bit more of an objective as opposed to a subjective means of evaluating someone's health and independence and really kind of help identify those patients who may be candidates for more intensive therapy throughout their myeloma kind of diagnosis, we'll say, and their treatment. So that is kind of where we've landed on transplant eligibility and ineligibility. But the concept is do we think people are well enough to undergo a bone marrow transplant?
So now let's talk about that group of transplant ineligible patients, people who might be not strong enough for their body to endure this treatment. What is, first of all, the most common type of treatment that this group of people usually get?
So a bit of an evolution as well. I mean, what a wonderful problem that we've had so many new drugs developed in multiple myeloma. And when drugs do get developed, first they are approved for patients who have had many prior treatments and they're looking for the next newest and greatest. And that's usually how the FDA approves these drugs. They approve it and say, let's just start with this group of patients. But over the years, it gets tested with more and more patients earlier on in their diagnosis. So one of the things that patients with newly diagnosed myeloma who are not planning or not eligible or too frail to go to transplant have enjoyed is the addition of daratumumab to the first treatment you receive when you're diagnosed. So daratumumab, I like to describe, is a bit of a magnet, if you will. So we think of it, it's technically called a monoclonal antibody. But what it is it is a medicine that predominantly is given as a shot. And that medicine is injected. It is particularly looking for a sign on the myeloma cells that says, hey, this is me. And when it finds it, like a magnet sticks to it and helps pop it open. And it pops it open with many different approaches, but it's a real kind of targeted treatment and uses your immune system to help kill as well. So I really have seen daratumumab kind of evolve into the gift that keeps on giving because it really has helped so many patients in various time points in their disease. Now being so effective, why wait? Why can't we use it when patients are first diagnosed? So that has really now, I think, turned into the optimal treatment as a basis for when older, frailer, weaker, less healthy people, let's say, are diagnosed with myeloma. So, but remember, we like to use multiple drugs. I think of it as like the old game of Clue, right? Instead of just using a handle stick or a revolver, a lead pipe, you know, we want to use all the tools we have together as a cocktail so that we can approach the myeloma and sneak up on it and kill it from different ways. So daratumumab is great in combination with many different treatments. And so I'd say the front runner right now for patients like you describe is the combination of daratumumab with good old lenalidomide, also known as Revlimid, plus or minus dexamethasone. You know, the Maya trial was designed for patients that we're talking about. They got the combination of three medicines, the daratumumab, lenalidomide, and dexamethasone. And they compared it to patients in that same group and only gave them two of the medicines, the lenalidomide and dexamethasone. The whole point was to understand, is three better than two? And if so, how can daratumumab help improve, you know, above and beyond just the two? And it was designed for patients when they were first diagnosed, not going to transplant, and use these treatments for as long as they are effective and as long as it's tolerated by the patient. And so the Maya trial over the last many years, we've seen kind of updates and updates that come out that tell us time and time again that the three medicines combined together are extremely successful combination to get people into remission, keep them there. And the durability is because we are killing so much myeloma. The myeloma you can see above the surface, myeloma you can see under the surface, that's very hard to detect. We're just killing it all. And by making the myeloma stay away, people are living longer. So we're seeing all these outcomes and results from the Maya trial kind of year after year showing that the successes of these three medicines together is great because it works and it lasts.
The other thing that patients always are concerned about are side effects. So are there more side effects with the four drugs than the three drugs? What about quality of life? What are you seeing in your clinic?
Great question. So, you know, the addition of daratumumab to any of these regimens, fortunately, is a reasonably well-tolerated medication. So it is initially a little more kind of inconvenient because of the frequency of the dosing. So remember, this drug is given once a week for 8 weeks, and then it's given every 2 weeks for another 8 times. But after those first 6 months, it goes down to once a month, which is a very attractive option for patients. Oftentimes when they can just come in once a month, get their blood drawn, get a shot and get out of there. So from a truly kind of quality of life from inconvenience perspective, I think it's a really nice option. Now, from side effects, though, what I would also say is that the kind of greater side effect we think about, there's probably two, I would say, that we've learned a lot in the midst of a COVID era, is two things. One is the very small risk. It's 1 out of 10 patients with the first injection may have what we call an injection-related reaction, where patients may, kind of like a bee sting, have a variety of reactions, I should say. Like a bee sting, you may get a little red spot, but some other people may need to have an EpiPen. So this is how I kind of rationalize it or think about it a little bit, is that we have to, with your first dose, kind of stare at you a little bit and make sure that you're not having those reactions. But again, 1 out of 10. After that first administration, the likelihood of having a reaction is somewhere about 1-2% thereafter. So very low. So the reaction risk is small, but important. The second one, and I think is a little bit more relevant these COVID era days, is that, you know, multiple myeloma patients inherently have a weakened immune system. Their immune system is so busy making myeloma that it's not making adequate amounts of your normal immunity. If you take a drug that's designed to kill the immune system problem, you're going to take some innocent bystanders with it, right? So the daratumumab is going to try and kill all those myeloma cells, but those myeloma cells are plasma cells, right? Plasma cells are designed to make the weapons you need to kill the bad guys, whatever it is, the flu, the COVID, the pneumonia, whatever. And so if we are taking patients who are already have a somewhat weakened immune system or trying to get their immune system to build back up, there is going to be some effect on the immune system that puts patients more at risk for getting colds, COVID, pneumonia, sinus infections, whatever it is. And so it's important to make sure we are prepared from that, vaccinating against the handful of different things we know are important for vaccination for myeloma patients, whether it's COVID or flu or pneumonia. And sometimes using preventative antibiotics when patients are first diagnosed. But I'm glad to say that unlike some of our other medications that we use with myeloma that cause neuropathy, where you have that numbness or diarrhea or for severe fatigue, things that really can affect your day-to-day lifestyle, I don't think daratumumab affects it that as much.
The field is moving really fast. Things are changing once or twice or three times or 10 times a year. You know, we've had multiple drugs approved in the last 4 years, even through COVID, we still saw drug approvals. And so I think that the field is moving fast enough that if you have a really good general oncologist, they may be able to keep up to date, but they may not know the latest and greatest. And for that reason, I think having a myeloma center of record, if you will, a place that's close to you, a team you feel comfortable with that can partner with your local oncologist, really guarantees that you're getting access to the latest and greatest, not just agents or combinations, but that your team knows what approaches are going to be the most forward-thinking approaches to keep you going for the longest period of time.